join me in a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for bringing us here tonight. Again, Father, safe and sound, Lord, to worship you and to praise you. You who has given us everything. Father, you are great and you are good. We rest in you tonight, Father God, that you speak again to your people, Lord. Father, I pray for your anointing. I pray for you to bless this message, Lord God, at the same time to override it, Lord. Father, may you open the eyes of the hearts of those whom you have chosen to be a part of your kingdom and your family. Father, I pray for those who are discouraged, Father God, may they be encouraged this evening. And I pray for those who are lost, Father, I pray that you bring them back again tonight. We love you, Lord, and we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Okay, we have a lot to cover tonight. Right off the bat, if you are sleepy, there's coffee, okay? Feel free to get up and grab yourself a cup of coffee. There's as much as I tried to summarize the book of Job tonight, we're going to stop with our, now we're going to stop. Tonight we're going to be talking about the story of Job. So we were doing the journey in the 1 Corinthians, but we're going to change it. So hopefully, if you are tired, just put your hands up and then shake them, okay? That's what we do in the plane, you know, the 16-hour flight going back to the Philippines. You have those exercises that you do while you're sitting down. Do that while I'm doing this. And if your friend, your brother or sister is falling asleep, make sure you catch them. We don't want anybody hurt tonight. Okay, let's start. Our title of our message is God Still Good Even in Our Pain and Trials? It's a question. It's a question for everybody to ask. Is he still good when we're going through trials or we're having pain? In the midst of pain, can we still say God is good? Now we're going to see in the story of Job how he went through this and how Job or how God revealed himself. Let's begin. In Psalm 34:8, it reads, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in him." And in Proverbs 3:5, it says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding." Can you trust in the Lord? Can you still say that God is good? Can you give everything up to Him when things are not making sense? Can you still say? But that's what he's telling us. That's what He's asking us to do. That's what the psalmist is trying to tell us. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Have you tasted how good God is? Have you? That's not a strong, that's fine. We'll try to, hopefully in your journey in life, the next time we ask that question, your answer will be a loud amen. Because not everybody really have tasted God, that God is good. Because we're living a superficial life. Even Christians live superficial lives. If I just go to church, if I do my Bible reading, if I give my tithes, but then it's just all surface. It's everything that we see. Everything that we can do, but we're not really getting into the intimate details of God. We haven't really tasted how good God is. You know when you're eating that steak? I love steak. I haven't mentioned steak again. So steak, when that steak is so good, you don't want to just swallow it, right? Although I have that bad habit. I just put it in my mouth and just boom, boom. I don't even chew it. But if it's really good, what you need to do is chew on that. And just enjoy each flavor and savor before you swallow it. That's what he's saying. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. But again, the question is he still good when we're going through trials? Is he still good when we're going through painful things in life? And life is difficult, correct? Life is difficult. The sooner you accept this, life will no longer be difficult. But if you have this naive thinking that life should be good, you know what? My life should have been good if I stayed in the Philippines. That was my thinking when I moved here. And then when life wasn't turning out how the States wasn't coming out as turning out as I imagined it to be, I was thinking, I should just be back in the Philippines. My life would be so much better there. But it wasn't. It really wasn't, you know. But life is difficult. But can you say that God is still good when you feel, when you're going through heartaches? When you lose someone? Can you still say God is good? That's what we're going to see. And in James chapter 1, verse 2 to 4, it says, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of any kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. So if your maturity, if your spiritual maturity doesn't matter to God, then you're not going to go through trials. He's not going to put you through trials. Now, if you're thinking that you shouldn't mature spiritually, look at this again. Because our spiritual maturity matters to God. He wants all of us to grow in our faith. He wants us to continue to know who He is. Not the superficial Him, but who He truly is. So we're going to go see on what happened with Job. And I know most of us have gone through the story of Job. And as I was trying to make the study, do the study for Job, there's so much in the story of Job that we can all learn from. That maybe we should do a series on Job. But tonight, we're going to try to finish Job in an hour and a half. No, I'm kidding. They're like, oh my gosh. No, we're going to do it. Okay, we're going to try to see and simplify it tonight. Not simplify it, but summarize it. But before I get in there, I know that you see a lot of empty seats, but this is how life is. Life always throws something at us that it seems to be more important than praising God. Amen? I know tonight the Warriors are playing. The Warriors and another team is playing. They're playing, right? And some of us, we really need, if your husband or your wife loves sports and they can't come here, you know what you need to do? You need to take that remote control and bring it here to church. Hold, keep it with you, okay? All right. So in the Old Testament, sin and suffering were connected, okay, because of the nature of the covenant. It was believed that keeping God's statutes resulted in sin, and not keeping them resulted in cursing. This is in Leviticus chapter 26, verse 1 to 46, Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 1 to 68. Even though Job lived before the law was given, such a natural law would have been understood. So Job's friends could be excused for assuming that Job is guilty of a secret sin. Okay, we all know, right, what happened to Job. As you go through these verses on your own time, when you leave tonight, if you want to pick up your Bible and read through Job, that's why his friends were just hammering him about just confess that sin that you've committed. And then God will lay off his hand on you, off you. So let's go see it. Talk about Job here. There once was a man named Job who lived in the land of Oz. He was blameless, a man of complete integrity. He feared God and stayed away from evil. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters. He owned 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 teams of oxen, and 500 female donkeys. He also had many servants. He was, in fact, the richest person in that entire area. He was tremendously blessed because he was good to God. He was obedient to God. One day, the members of the heavenly court came to present themselves before the Lord, and the accuser, Satan, came with them. This is where on verse 6. Where have you come from? The Lord asked Satan. Satan answered the Lord, I have been patrolling the earth, watching everything that's going on. Then the Lord asked Satan, have you noticed my servant Job? He is the finest man in all the earth. He is blameless. A man of complete integrity, he fears God and stays away from evil. As you can see there, I know we're, what, it's 2017, right? And we're all adults here. And we don't, we're told that not to believe in ghosts, right? We're not, you're laughed at if you believe in ghosts and all that stuff, because, you know, I would laugh at you too. But the one thing that the world or Satan has been trying to do, and he's doing a good job, is making people think that he does not exist. Okay? If he can't make you not believe that there is a God, he's going to make you think that he doesn't exist. So as you can see in these verses here, Satan was mentioned. And he's called the accuser of the brother. Right? He accuses us. He doesn't want us to be blessed. He doesn't want that. He hates us. Especially if you've surrendered your life to Christ, he hates you. Because you know why? Because we're going to go to heaven and he's not. And he committed only one sin at one time, and he was already damned. And us, because of God's grace through Jesus, we've committed all these sins. Our sins have been forgiven yesterday, today, and tomorrow. So he envies us. He hates us. So he accuses the brother. It's the same thing what he did to Peter, as we can see in the next verses. And then you see here that God was the one. It was God's idea to say, hey, have you considered my servant Job? Now, Job does not know this, okay? The author is telling us, and we have the privilege of reading it. But Job, when this was happening, he didn't know this. You and I are being accused by Satan up there. But praise God for Jesus, because Jesus is our advocate. He's the one that defends us. If you have surrendered your life to Christ, he is the one that defends for us. Jesus is actually praying for us too. The accuser of the brother. Job 1, verse 9 to 11. Satan replied to the Lord, yes, but Job has good reason to fear God. You have always put a wall of protection around him and his home and his property. You have made him prosper in everything he does. Look how rich he is. But reach out and take away everything he has, and he will surely curse you to your face. What Satan is saying, well, of course he's going to praise you. Of course he's going to love you, because you've blessed him tremendously. He's accusing Job of what? Hypocrisy, right? Or there's another word that he was accusing him of. It was just because he's getting the benefits, of course he's not going to do anything against God. Right? He's accusing him of that. And then the other thing he's accusing, the other person he's accusing is God. He's accusing God of not being fair. Right? So you blessed him. So of course he's going to love you. So that's not fair. He's doing that. That's what he does. That's what Satan does. That's what the enemy does to our lives. Okay? If there's something that's happening at our work, and he causes you to think, well, shoot, that's your boss's favorite. Maybe you shouldn't work too hard anymore. You never get the promotion that you've been applying for. Stop being nice, you know? You know what? Things will never change with you and your husband. You might as well just leave him. There's a reason why they invented divorce. That's the other lie, right? There's so many things that the world is now telling us that it should be right, while the Bible's telling us it's wrong. Do we agree? Now, we're the ones who are weird. So that's how crafty the enemy is. What I want us to focus on, one thing that we need to focus on, is the existence of Satan. Not that he's more powerful than our God, because he's not. But just know that the enemy is out there to get us. And that's why the prayer, praying for everyone, for the leaders, for the couples, for your children, for your spouse, for safety. It's true. We need to cover ourselves with prayers. Because one thing that the enemy hates is Christian praying. Because God hears a believer's prayer. Amen? He doesn't believe the non-believer's prayers. The only prayer that a non-believer, a prayer that a non-believer will say and God will hear is the prayer of repentance, right? So we're going to continue. In Luke 22, verse 31 to 32, we see here in these two verses how Satan accuses the brother. Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift all of you as wheat, but I have prayed for you, Simon, that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned back, strengthen your brothers. In Revelation, for the accuser of our brothers and sisters who accuses them before our God day and night. Day and night. That's what he's doing. Continuously trying to accuse us. That's his job. He wants to continue to just demolish us, discourage us, discredit us. So we need to be aware of this. But as we continue with this, we will see that Jesus is our advocate. Jesus intercedes for us. In John 17, 20 to 23, it reads, "My prayer," this is Jesus speaking, "my prayer is not for them alone," speaking about the disciples. "I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one. Father, just as you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. And the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me." His prayer, Jesus' prayer, is that we will all be one. We'll be united. Because we're stronger together. Amen? We are stronger together. I was just telling a sister before the service started that how can we experience God's love here and now is through each other. Amen? That's how we experience God's love now. As we help each other. As we check on each other. As we comfort each other. That's how we feel God now. That's how we experience God now. Through our brothers and our sisters. And that's Jesus' prayer. But he's praying for us. Know that even up to now, Jesus is praying for you. Us. In Romans 8:33, this is Jesus is our advocate. Romans 8:33 to 34, "Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God, and is also interceding for us." That sounded like my phone. I felt like I was the one that didn't turn off my phone. 1 John 2, verse 1 to 2, "My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the world." Jesus is our advocate. Amen? Israel's high priest entered the presence of God to intercede in a tabernacle made with hands. Jesus now intercedes in a tabernacle not of this creation, the very presence of God himself in heaven. Jesus' present ministry of advocacy and intercession has everything to do with where he is now seated. He's seated at the right hand of God. If Satan comes into the presence of God to accuse one of the followers of Christ, the intercessor is there at God's right hand to hear the charge and move to defend and advocate for that person. Amen? Jesus is always there defending for us. Jesus is always there praying for us. It is God's will that we avoid sin. However, if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. Like a lawyer in a courtroom, Jesus pleads our case before the Father. He does not defend us for sinning. Instead, he pleads his own precious blood as the price paid to cover the sins of those who belong to him. Do we understand this? Amen? So you cannot lose your salvation. If you have accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior one time, that's it. God's desire is that we don't sin. But the thing is, we can't. You think it, you sinned it already. It's already a sin. And we always think, we always get angry. We're always selfish sometimes, or time to time. We sometimes lie, right? So, but Jesus has paid for it. That Jesus has paid it all, that's a great hymn. Amen? Because he did. One of the most important points that the Apostle Paul makes concerning the love of God has to do with Christ's present ministry of intercession. When Paul asks rhetorically, who is he that condemns? The answer is, there is none. There is no one who can condemn. God's elect. We are God's elect, including Satan. Why? Because it is Christ who died. And furthermore, he also was risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. The same person who took the punishment for our sins is the one who intercedes for his own. The one who intercedes for us is the quote-unquote propitiation of our sins. That's in 1 John chapter 4, verse 10. And the protector of our faith. Amen? Is that clear? Yes, Satan is real. Yes, Satan accuses us. Every opportunity that he can get, he accuses us. He doesn't want us to be blessed. He doesn't want us to be happy. And then when he's making us happy, it's a lie. You know, if you're sinning and you get away with it, and then you get away with it, and then you get away with it, and then all of a sudden, boom, your life's just a big mess. Because he's the father of lies. He fell into his lie. He fell into this trap. But Jesus is our advocate. He's our intercessor. That's what Jesus is doing. Other than dying on the cross for us, Jesus continues to work and help us. Amen? We continue with Job. Job chapter 1, verse 12. This is God's sovereignty. We're going to see God's sovereignty in the book of Job. All right, you may test him. The Lord said to Satan, do whatever you want with everything he possesses, but don't harm him physically. So Satan left the Lord's presence. We see here God's sovereignty. Job suffered so he might have a deeper, just in case I miss it later, Job suffered so he might have a deeper and more accurate knowledge of God. This happened without him knowing about this conversation between Satan and God. Do you understand? But Romans 8:28 says, for we know that all things God works for the good of those who love him. So now, God's going to reveal to Job a new thing that Job doesn't know about God. As you will see in these verses here, in Job 1 to 13 to 15, that's when his oxen and donkeys were stolen by and his farmers were all killed by some Sabaean raiders. That's like, the raiders are bad, I'm telling you. If you like the Raiders, you should just change teams right now. And in Job 1 to 16, his sheep and shepherds were killed by a fire from heaven. And then his camels and his servants were killed by some Chaldean raiders again. And his children were killed by a tornado. All in one day. How about getting that for a news, huh? How about getting that as a text message or a phone call? The one call's not over yet, and you get another call. That call's not even done yet, you get another call. And all this is what you're getting. This happened in one day. Can you still say that God is good? Can you still say that God is good when you're going through this? Are you like Job? That you will respond like this? Job stood up and tore his robe in grief. Then he shaved his head and fell to the ground to worship. He said, I came naked from my mother's womb, and I will be naked when I leave. The Lord gave me what I had, and the Lord has taken it away. Praise the name of the Lord. In all of this, Job did not sin by blaming God. We are not like Job. Praise God. Right? The trials that Job has faced, none of us can probably bear. Because this is what happens to us. Something happens at the house, we miss church. Something happens at our work, we stop praising God. Some trouble happens with our children, we stop praising God. Because we say, well, if you can help me with this, what's the point of me worshiping you? I thought you could do all things. Why can't you keep this together for me? For some of us, not all of us. But look, fell to the ground to worship. The Lord giveth, the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. As we mature in our faith, that's why God brings this trouble. He brings trouble in our lives. He brings heartaches in our lives because He wants us to know more of Him. He wants us to pray more to Him. He wants us to really know who He is. Troubles is not to deter us away from Him. Trouble is to bring us closer to Him. Amen? But our natural reaction is somewhat defeating. We go back to our old ways. Before, when I, unfortunately, you know, to my shame, before when I have trouble at the house, I go back to drinking because that's what I was used to. I'll go out and look for my friends who are not believers yet and, you know, I'll tell them, hey, let's go drink. I got problems at the house. Buy me some cigarettes, buy me some beer, and I'll do it because I'm numbing myself, thinking that's how I'm going to solve my problem. Then I'll stop coming to church. Stop reading my Bible. Stop praying. Because for some reason, my actions and my heart, and sometimes I said it, what I was sharing with you guys, if you can't help me with this, then what's the point? But boy, was I wrong. And praise God that God never gives up on us. Amen? He never gives up on us. He's going to continue. He's going to continue because He's good. Because He is good. He's not going to give up on us. He's going to continue. If He's not a good God, He'll give up on you. But trust me. Trust in what the Bible says. He will not give up on you. Amen? I will never leave you nor forsake you. Let's continue. Job 2, verse 4 to 8. Skin for skin, Satan replied. A man will give all he has for his own life. But now stretch out your hand and strike his flesh and bones, and he will surely curse you to your face. The Lord said to Satan, Very well then, he is in your hands, but you must spare his life. Satan went back there and then same conversation, and Job and God again offered Job, how about my boy Job? Have you considered my boy Job? Imagine the flattery. Think about this. When you're going through problems, because God is sovereign, He allowed it. Because He wants you to experience that. Because He wants you to grow. He wants us to grow. He made us. He knows how far He can stretch us. Amen? And He knows better. He knows best. He's sovereign. He doesn't have to ask for your permission. He is sovereign. He is good. You have to trust that He is good, no matter how difficult it is. We have to keep our hope on Him as well. That things will get better. We just can't let go of Him. Amen? So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and afflicted Job with painful sores from the soles of his feet to the crown of his head. Then Job took a piece of broken pottery and scraped himself with it as he sat among the ashes. That's how much it was hurting or itching him. He took a scrape of pottery and just doing it because it was just really hurting or itchy from head to toe. After what happened to you, you went bankrupt, you lost your children, and then now you're sick. How can people say, how can there be a God, a good God, if all these evil things are happening in the world? How can you still say that there's a good God when all these things, the children that are getting hurt by these evil people, the injustice that's happening with other, you know, in different countries or to other families, the pain that's out there, how can there be a good God despite all of that? And Job's right here. What's going on? Job, as we saw in the first verse, he was upright with the Lord. But then things happen that hurts us. This is Job. So Job's friends could be excused. Oh, wait. The Bible adds more ingredients to the recipe for suffering. Because before, what they believe is you'll suffer if you're disobedient. You won't be blessed. You only get blessed if you're obedient to Him. But this book shows us that there's other recipe for suffering. First, righteous people like Job do sometimes suffer. Amen? Righteous does not mean totally sinless, but upright in God's sight. How do we become upright with God? How do we become righteous with God? If we accepted Christ as our Lord and Savior. The book of Job portrays Job as a faithful man who honestly tried to do the right thing before God and who acknowledged his errors and sought to correct things when he faltered. Because you will see in chapter 42, verse 1 to 6, he was already faltering there. He kept asking because God was silent. Still, he suffered, but not because of sin. So deeper questions must be asked and answered. Job asked, but he got an answer. He got an answer he was not expecting. Second, a third party operates between God and man. We've seen it with God's permission. In Job, we see Satan's primary method of spiritual warfare, attempting to discredit God in man's sight. That's one. Satan cannot harm God, but he can attempt to influence how man perceives God, whether as unjust, unfair, or unloving. Satan causes Job to suffer unjustly in an attempt to get Job to attack God. That's what Satan wants us to do when he asks God to send us trouble, because he wants us to accuse God and get mad at him. He also accuses Job of self-serving, trying to make God look unjust in the eyes of the heavenly host for not punishing a sinner like Job. But Satan's plot is foiled by the third variable, that there can be godly purposes in suffering, unrelated to sin or punishment. Job suffered so he might have a deeper and more accurate knowledge of God. This happened without him knowing. In a matter of probably hours, Job lost everything that was important to him except his wife and his own life. But he held fast to his integrity, determined to unravel the mystery of why he, a man who had done his utmost to live an upright life, was being treated by God as the chief of sinners. this type of punishment is for a big sinner. That's how they saw it before. If he was a sinner deserving of divine punishment, he demanded his friends to tell him what he had done, which they could not. He also asked the same of God and received more silence in response. His wife said to him, "Are you still maintaining your integrity? Curse God and die." He replied, "You are talking like a foolish woman. Shall we accept good from God and not trouble?" In all this, Job did not sin in what he said. Do you only see God as someone who should just give you blessings? Did you become a Christian to just get blessings from Him? Because you read in a book that if you can name it and claim it, that's it, you know? Voila, you got it. You use God as an ATM, a genie with unlimited wishes. Sometimes, unfortunately, sincere believers are sincerely wrong too when it comes to that. That we only take blessings from God, but we can't take problems from Him. The Israelites were released from Egypt, right? And a 9-week journey to the promised land was not how God told him how to go. He took him to the longer route, right? Sometimes the short route is not always the best route. When you're trying to strengthen your body, you work out. Either you lift weights or you do some exercise, there's some resistance to work out your muscle. And that's not a pleasing feeling. That burn in your muscle, right? If you've worked out, it hurts, right? And if you're not hurting, you got to increase the weight. If you want to continue to get bigger and stronger, you got to build up the resistance. Increase the resistance. It's the same thing. God knows it. God knows what's best for us. And He is good. We can trust that He is good. He knows what we need. Amen? He knows how far He can take us. We don't know. He knows. In all of that, Job did not sin. When Job's three friends, Eliphaz and Temanite, Bildad, the Shuhite, so far, the Namathite, I tried to practice this, but I heard about all the troubles that had come upon him. They set out from their homes and met together by agreement to go and sympathize with him and comfort him. When they saw him from a distance, they could hardly recognize him. They began to weep aloud, and they tore their robes and sprinkled dust on their heads. Then they sat on the ground with him for 7 days and 7 nights. No one said a word to him, because they saw how great his suffering was. This was the best moment of his friends. This was it. If they would have just maintained their silence, they would have been good. But they had to open their mouth, just like us. You know, sometimes all we need to do is be there for our brothers and our sisters. We don't need to open our mouth. We just need to listen. Give them our shoulder when we're comforting someone. Just give them our shoulder. If you're like me, you have a hard time shutting up, you have to pray for God, for self-control. Because sometimes the best advice is just your presence there. And you listening. Amen? In Genesis 50, verse 10, when they reached the threshing floor of Atad near the Jordan, they lamented loudly and bitterly. And there Joseph observed a 7-day period of mourning for his father Jacob. Matthew 5:4. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. By who? By God. God, the creator of the universe, comforts like a father to his children. He will comfort us. And it says here, rejoice with those who rejoice, mourn with those who mourn. Ecclesiastes 7:2-4. It is better to go to a house of mourning than to go to a house of feasting. For death is the destiny of everyone. The living should take this to heart. Frustration is better than laughter, because a sad face is good for the heart. The heart of the wise is in the house of mourning, but the heart of fools is in the house of pleasure. This is all upside down of what the world's telling us, right? Laughter is the best medicine. Live your life to the fullest. Don't be sad. Right? Remember that song? Be happy. Don't worry. Right? How can you be happy when somebody died that you love? You could really do the whistle? My wife. Yeah? Can you? No. There's time to mourn. If you lose somebody, you mourn. And it's good. The Bible says it's okay. And when you go to a house of mourning, you know why we become wise? Whenever I go, and you know, when I visit my friends for the last time, I think of my life on how I should spend it. When I was with Brother Chuck at the hospital, I met one of his daughters. And I said, how is Chuck as a dad? And she goes, oh, he rarely gets mad. And I know when he's mad when he says this, that's enough. Can you imagine, Brother Chuck? I can imagine him saying, that's enough. And I already know I'm in trouble when he says, that's enough. And I stop. I have to stop, he said. So as she was saying that, I was thinking in my head, oh, my daughter is not going to say the same thing. She's not going to say the same thing because I always get mad. And I'm always yelling. But she said, Chuck is just so relaxed. He's a laid-back dad. I'm strict, especially with my daughter. You know, and it's just you learn things. So I was telling myself, you know what? I need to be a laid-back dad too. And I saw how his kids were there before they took him in for when they had to pump his lung. They were happy. They were joking. Chuck was joking around with us. It was different. But then when we lost Chuck for a few minutes with Atiella, we were all mourning. We were not singing, don't worry, be happy. We were mourning with Atiella. But at the same time, we were celebrating to the fact that God has welcomed our brother in heaven. Amen? That Chuck is in a better place. And all of a sudden, we start being envious. Like, man, Chuck, why do we have to go first? We were jealous all of a sudden. Why do you need to go first? But you know, we need to learn these things. We need to know and believe these things. This is from the Bible. Okay? Frustration is better than laughter. Why? Because you learn, right? You learn. When you're always successful, when you're always doing the right thing, and all of a sudden everything crumbles, and you've always been successful all your life, how do you know how to handle that failure? The most successful people in this world are the ones who have made a lot of mistakes. And they will tell you that. They will tell you that. I am where I am because I made a lot of mistakes. They kept going. Michael Jordan said, I've missed more winning shots than I made them. So we have to learn from these things. And going back, now a summary, chapters 3 through 7 is the accusations and answers between Job and his friends. We're not going to go through it. You can go through it on your own. Chapters 28, verse 1 through 42 to 6 is the discourses by Job, Elihu, and God. And then chapters 42, chapter 42, verse 7 to 17 is Job's understanding of God and the restoration. Faith in the storm is what we see in the book of Job. Job speaks of foundational themes every human being contends with, especially in times of suffering. Number one, God's character. The book of Job defends the character of a loving and righteous God in spite of earth's obvious evils and injustices. Although Job was unaware of the interaction between Satan and God, Job comes to the conclusion that God is just and good. That is the lesson of the book for anyone who questions God without access to all the facts. He can go through that through chapters 38, verse 1, to chapter 42, verse 6. We have to also see here trust. Trust. Job was forced to walk by faith rather than by sight. He couldn't see. He didn't know about chapter 42 that he was going to be restored. All he knew was his children died. He went bankrupt. Now he's sick. But he did not let go of God. He trusted in God. He walked by faith, not by sight. That's 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7. He could not see what the reader sees in chapters 1 and 2. Job's perspective is best summarized in chapter 13, verse 15. Though he may slay me, yet I will trust him. Even so, I will defend my own ways before him. Job continued to plead his innocence before God, but was prepared to die trusting him. It's okay to lift up our frustrations to God when we're praying. We need to be honest. He already knows what you're going to say. He knows what's in your heart. There's no right or wrong when you're praying to God. God will correct. If we're prideful as we're praying, God will let us know you're prideful. If we're grumbling, he's going to say, your eyes are not on me. Put your eyes on me. And this is the one thing. Sovereignty. Although Satan wreaked havoc in Job's life on earth, the limits of his activity were and are, up to now, clearly set by God. Satan can go only so far. This serves as a template for viewing evil on earth. Satan does not operate as a free agent, but is always under the sovereign and deciding hand of God. Amen? That's who our God is. The attributes of God make clear that God is supreme over all. He yields to no other power, authority, or glory, and is not subject to any absolute greater than himself. He represents perfection to an infinite degree in every aspect of his being. He represents perfection to an infinite degree in every aspect of his being. He can never be surprised, defeated, or uncertain. However, without sacrificing his authority or jeopardizing the final realization of his perfect will, it has pleased God to give to men a measure of freedom of choice. And for the exercise of this choice, God holds man responsible. Because man is in his depraved state, is blind and insensitive to the work of God, it is clear from Scripture that men do not turn to God apart from the moving of his Spirit in their hearts. On the human side, however, man is held responsible for unbelief and is commanded to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ in order to be saved. It is also true that in the affairs of men, especially of Christians, God works to accomplish his will. Philippians 2:13. Yet he does not force men to yield themselves to God, but rather beseeches them to do so. The fact that God has given to man certain freedoms does not introduce an element of uncertainty into this universe. As God anticipates in advance and knows to infinity all that man will do in response to the divine and human influences. That's Lewis Schaeffer talking about God's sovereignty. God is sovereign. He will do whatever he thinks he needs to do or he has already planned to do for our good. And he knows it. He knows it better than you and I can come up with. He has the better plan. So do you trust him? Do you trust him? The funny thing with Christians is we can trust God going to heaven because we believe in his Son. As the Lord said, we believe that he can take us to heaven. We believe in eternal life. But we can't believe God can make it better here and now. For some of us, We believe God can take us to heaven because we believe in God and what Jesus did on the cross. But we don't believe, God, that He can make our lives better here. How stupid is that? Seriously. How can you believe in the afterlife, but yet you can't believe that He can make your life better? If you're considering about killing yourself, and you're a believer, and you're considering about killing yourself, that's a bad way to meet our God. It won't surprise God, but what are you going to say? Hey, Joe. Hey, Lord. You're here early? Yeah. I just didn't think you could solve my problems. So, but I know you can bring me here in heaven. That I believe. But that part there, I don't think you could solve it. What is that? Job did not let go of God. He was asking, why? I did everything right. This is not how it's supposed to be. What did I do, Lord? His friends were saying, you have a secret sin. Just confess. He goes, no, I don't. You're the worst advisors. With your kind of friends, who needs friends? You know? God can solve our problems. Amen? He can. He knows better. Sometimes you're going to get fired at your job. Why? Because God has another better place for you to be in. I got laid off at work in the airport when I used to be a screener before it became federal. When it became federal, I got laid off. It was in the middle of us trying to buy a house. My mother-in-law flew here from the Philippines to help us through the process. But then I got laid off because I was colorblind. God made me colorblind. That didn't make me colorblind, okay? Contrary to popular belief, I'm not stupid. It's just, I was created that way. So I couldn't see. There, one of the tests was, you can't be colorblind. And I needed that job to keep that job so I can get the house with Anna. But I got laid off. The girl wanted me to cheat, but I was already in love with the Lord then, and I was in the right place at the right time with Him. And I said, Lord, the girl wants me to cheat, but I think you know better. If you can let me pass through this, and if you're colorblind, it's 15 caps, just so you know. 15 caps. It's called D15 Farnsworth test. It's for colorblind people. Or to test if you're colorblind. See, it's from dark to light, or from light to dark. And then you put it in a tube, and you sequence that thing. If you're colorblind, it's the same shade. You're like, what's the difference here? But the answer was on the back of the tube. So the girl goes, I'm going to check your test. Watch me check your test. She was already telling me, watch me check your test. She flipped the tube, and the numbers were there. The sequence was there. Then she drops the whole thing, and then she goes, take it again. And she walks out and looks outside the window, basically telling me, go ahead. Do what you need to do. And you know what? Before I was a believer, I know cheating. It got me through high school. That was my way. I was like, oh, what? But, you know, as a new creation, God was telling me, I have something better for you. Did I lose the job? Yes, I lost the job. Was I employed for a long time? Yes, I was. But God had a better plan for me. The same thing with you. God always has a better plan for us. Amen? And look at the restoration here. Before we do that, let's look at the conversation between the Lord and Job. Then the Lord spoke to Job out of the storm. He said, where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? Tell me if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched out a measuring line across it? On what were its footings set? Or who laid its cornerstone? God was basically telling Job, do you even know this? I did this. Our God is powerful. He created the universe just by saying it. And He can get you through whatever trials or pain that we're having or you're having. Amen? So stop questioning him. Stop questioning him. If you know what, you can continue. Continue to wrestle with him. Continue to wrestle with God. In humility, continue to wrestle with him. And he will answer you and show you who he is. In chapter 42, verse 1 to 6, then Job replied to the Lord, I know that you can do all things. No purpose of yours can be thwarted. You asked, who is this that obscures my plans without knowledge? Surely I spoke of things I did not understand. Job was confessing. He was asking for forgiveness. Things too wonderful for me to know. You said, listen now and I will speak. I will question you and you shall answer me. My ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. Therefore I despise myself and I repent in dust and ashes. When you get to that place of intimacy with the Lord, you will never be sorry. You will not regret it. Once you get there and know that our God is good, that no matter what you're going through, He will see you through. Amen? And He knows your pain. He knows your tears. He counts our tears in a bottle. Right? He knows. I can even hold a tear. He knows. God is good. Amen? And God is powerful. Amen? 42:7-9. After the Lord had said these things to Job, he said to Eliphaz the Temanite, I am angry with you. Look, God was talking to his friends and your two friends because you have not spoken the truth about me as my servant Job has. So now take 7 bulls and 7 rams and go to my servant Job and sacrifice a burnt offering for yourselves. My servant Job will pray for you and I will accept his prayer and not deal with you according to your folly. You have not spoken the truth about me as my servant Job has. So Eliphaz the Temanite, Bildad the Shuhite, and Zophar the Naamathite did what the Lord told them. The Lord has accepted Job's prayer. They weren't even believers. They weren't even believers. Because now he asked Job to pray for them. We're almost done. 2 more slides. After Job had prayed for his friends, the Lord restored his fortunes and gave him twice as much as he had before. All his brothers and sisters and everyone who had known him before came and ate with him in his house. They comforted him. They comforted and consoled him over all the trouble the Lord had brought on him. And each one gave him a piece of silver and gold ring. Everybody will witness it too. Once God restores you from the trouble or trial or sickness, everyone will see it. Everyone that knew that you were struggling with it, they will see it. Because it will glorify God. Amen? The Lord blessed the latter part of Job's life more than the former part. He had 14,000 sheep. He only had 7. He has 6,000 camels and 1,000 yoke of oxen and 1,000 donkeys. And he also had 7 sons and 3 daughters. That's the punishment to the wife. Do you agree? Sorry. I don't know what kind of labor thing they had before, but it looks like to me the wife was punished and Job was blessed. Because she said, no, curse him and die. Oh, now I'm going to give you 10 children for what you said. 10 times the labor, right? 10 kids, where was I? The first daughter he named Jemima, the second Keziah, and the third Keran Hapor. Nowhere were there found women as beautiful as Job's daughters. And their father granted them an inheritance along with their brothers. After this, Job lived 140 years. He saw his children and their children to the fourth generation. Imagine that. Imagine the blessings. And so Job died an old man and full of years. So, in Job's most dreadful and difficult season, the broken man caught startling glimpses of God and God's work in his life and beyond what he or anyone else can foresee. Before Jesus walked this earth as the God-man, Job saw one who would be redeemer, mediator, friend, guide, advocate, and perfecter of faith. Job saw these intense, beautiful images through his tears. Those who turn fully to God in their great sorrow, even if they argue, plead, and protest in his presence as Job did. You will find a pathway nearer to the tender mercies of heaven than they have ever walked before. Believers talk about trusting in the Lord with their whole heart and refusing to lean on to their own understanding. But no one really knows what that means until circumstances cast them headfirst into a dark and painful place. If we give ourselves fully to God in those moments, we will obtain keepsakes of Him to treasure now and forever. That's Dr. David Jeremiah. Please, let's close in prayer. But before we do that, life is full of trouble sometimes. As much as there are blessings, there are a lot of troubles. There are a lot of trying times. Some here at church have more than the other. But God is good. Amen? God is good. And He is powerful. And He will comfort us during those times. He will not give up on us, even if we have given up on Him. Let's just continue to trust Him and lean not on our own understanding. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we thank You for Your truth. The truth about Your sovereignty, Father God, that You have displayed to us through the book of Job, the story of Job and his life, Lord. Thank You, Father, for revealing that to us, if not for the first time again, Father. I pray for encouragement, Lord God, for the brother or sister that is going through heartaches and trials, Lord God, and pain. Father, I pray for them. Father, may You heal them. May You heal their broken heart, Lord. May You heal their broken spirit. May You heal their body, Father. May You comfort their minds, Lord God. Give them the peace that they need. Give them the healing that they need. Father, I pray for blessings for those of us, Lord God, that are comforting those who are hurting. Continue to bless them. Continue to give them the strength. Continue to affirm them that they are doing the right thing. Father, I pray for that soul, Lord God, that You have called this evening. Father, move them to finally surrender their lives to You, to trust You, to trust You with all their life, not the life now and the life later. We love You, Lord, and we thank You. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.